Over here. Did my text scare people away? Was that it? I don't know. But anyway, we know everybody's going to be joining us online, so we're going to worship the Lord with all of our hearts anyway, right? Even if they weren't joining us online. Amen? All right.
I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene, and wonder how he could love me, a sinner condemned unclean. How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. But sweet drops of blood for mine. We sing, how marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. And suffered and died alone. How marvelous, how wonderful, that my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. In glory, his face I at last shall see. 'Twill be my joy through the ages to sing his love for me. We sing, how marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. Sing, how marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. Thank you. are holy. Is the Lamb. Amen. Alleluia. Alleluia. For the Lord God Almighty reigns.
Blessing and glory.
for heaven.
Father, we come in your presence today. Just righty. Well, I want to welcome you to the service today. Good to see those of you that are here. We have a lot of people joining us online. And we're getting through the summer. And that's okay. That's okay. A lot of people on vacation. Just remind you that as soon as the service is over, we will have coffee fellowship next door that you're all invited to carry on more of what we just did. And need to continue to remind you to keep our distance. I think I'm going to reset the, I think Mike's on vacation this week, but we're going to reset the seats back to the traditional seating and then block off every other row. I think we understand the drill on, we'd be okay with that, right? We don't have to sit there and police this thing, but we're just going to set the rows up because as time has gone on, I think it's getting more and more awkward for people to sit apart and then sit together with the people they want. But we'll just put all the seats out, and that'll make it easier to choose. Good morning. This is Uta. Yeah. And anyway, a few things to make you aware of. The men's Bible study will be meeting tonight. Bring your lawn chairs, and we'll meet at 6 o'clock right outside these doors out behind the warehouse. Prayer meeting on Thursday morning at the Wright's house at 6402 Langwood. And we do have the carnival, which we are planning on going forward with. We have people, our people that are joining us are really excited about doing this. We just got a Boy Scout troop from Brookside I found out about this morning. And they're going to bring in it's like a Pinewood Derby thing, but you can build Lego cars. And you're going to have a lot of cool stuff going on. And hopefully we're going to have our obstacle course back again. And we're just working through how we can do it in the current climate we're in. But we can make this happen. Parkview is even interested in joining us, so we've got a lot of good things going on. You hear more about that. But if we need you to sign up to volunteer, we'll need a lot of help, like we usually do, and there's a sign up in the lobby, so I encourage you to do that on the way out. And we were also talking about, we're going to do this, we've done it in conjunction with the VW thing that they do next door, their club. They're not meeting this year, they're not going to be doing that, so we're going to go with a back-to-school theme. And one of the ideas we had is it would be really cool if we can provide masks for kids, because they're all going to be required to have masks to go to school. And so we're looking at some creative ways to come up with masks that would be fun for them. But the thing that would be the most important is to find some people to be willing to sew those. So if you'd be willing to do that, we'll find patterns for you and do what we can to help you out with that. Please let me know or let Virginia know, and we'll try to make that work the way it needs, but we're going to work on that and make it happen. The last thing is, let me just remind you, the Sacred Assembly we'll be having, which will be 2 weeks from last night, is that right? August 1st. And I want to encourage you to not only put that in your calendar, but to come into that meeting fasting, either a day, maybe a couple days, maybe 3 days, maybe even a week, I don't know, whatever God puts in your heart, but it'd be really good if we could all come into that fasting to that event, and we're just going to look forward to having an incredible time together. We're being joined with Latter Rain Ministries, African American church right down the street here, about our size, and they want to join us for that. So we're looking forward to a great time just to get before God and to pray for this city and to pray for the church to do its work here. All right, now am I missing anything? All right, I'm going to pray for the offering, and then if the band can come back up, we're going to sing and give again. And I appreciate your faithfulness to giving through this time and through the summer, and pray you continue to do that so we can continue to bless the Lord. Give faithfully so we can fix all the air conditioners. We have two big units that run this room and two big units that run that room. And yesterday, one on each side went out. So, well, actually, this one went out last week, and the repair guys came in, and we got it going, and then it's not working. So they're going to come back tomorrow, but we'll get it going for you. So we tried to cool it off as we could with what we had this morning, and I appreciate you being here and hanging in there with us. But we're here to worship the Lord, right? So let's pray. Father, take our gifts today and use them for your kingdom. Be glorified in your people. And we just pray you continue to be with us throughout the remainder of this time together. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you.
deep light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are, it's who you are. Waymaker, miracle work, promise keep, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Oh, sing. Waymaker, miracle work, promise keep, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Oh, we sing. Waymaker, miracle work, promise keep, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. 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 You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. We worship you, Lord.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. And Father, as we come today, we pray, O God, that you minister to us in this place. Let your word speak to us, O God. Thank you for your word. I just, day by day, week by week, I'm so thankful for all the words of eternal life that you've given us. Such a well-rounded and powerful collection of writings that come from your heart to us. So let us not take this for granted, but to just hear what the Spirit would say to us today and to the church. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Hallelujah. I think we've got a place. I guess they've extracted all the children. Thank you, Tanya, for... taking care of that this week. Barb has been back online every week. She had a family thing this week, so she wasn't with us, but Tanya's taken over, and we appreciate that. Well, we're going back today to the Sermon on the Mount, and we're going to come to some of the more well-known, or I should say even more of the well-known words of Jesus we find scattered through here. And we're even going to see if the source for a few well-known common phrases that are used today in everyday conversation. So if you have a Bible, again, I'd like to ask you to open up to Matthew chapter 5. Matthew chapter 5, we're going to begin in verse 38. So we're getting through this slowly but surely. Matthew 5. Beginning in verse 38. We're going to read five verses here. You have heard that it was said, eye for eye and tooth for tooth. But I tell you, do not resist an evil person. If anyone slaps you in the right cheek, turn to them the other cheek also. And if anyone wants to sue you and take your shirt, hand over your coat as well. If anyone forces you to go 1 mile, go with them 2 miles. Give to the one who asks you, and do not turn away from the one who wants to borrow from you. Well, let's start here with verse 38. You have heard it was said, eye for eye and tooth for tooth. As we've seen Jesus deconstructing the current beliefs and teachings of the spiritual leaders of his day, we come to this one, and I must say, this one comes across rather baffling. Because in Leviticus 24, we find these words, anyone who injures his neighbor is to be injured in the same manner, fracture for fracture, eye for eye, tooth for tooth. The one who has inflicted the injury must suffer the same injury. I mean, it's right there. Doesn't it say eye for eye and tooth for tooth? It seems pretty obvious. It seems pretty obvious that Jesus is contradicting a pretty clear teaching from the Bible. In the other antithesis statements we've already read, he seems to augment or push the particular teaching to the extreme. But here he seems to clearly contradict what we find in plain language in the book of Leviticus. And then we'll find the same command repeated in Deuteronomy 19. So the original law was giving some strong emphasis here. So is Jesus really fulfilling the law as he claimed? Or was he denying it? Was he changing it? To unwrap this properly, we need to do more than read a single verse out of the Old Testament. And this is an issue I've found up popping up more and more as you see some pretty nasty skeptics popping up today. Some of these are professional skeptics. They have advanced degrees, but they're God haters. And even with these degrees, these people who should know better, they look at things in the Old Testament completely out of context. Just one separate word. They just cut it out, extract it, and then say, well, look what the Bible says here. And they try to make God and his word look bad. Well, the law of Moses, as we call it, is a complex interconnection of a lot of things, and it takes time for us to study it and understand not only what it says, but why. And as we look at what seems to be such an obvious message as this, eye for eye, tooth for tooth, but we look at all the other laws and conditions the Lord gave his people, we can unpack this the way it's supposed to be, and that's what we're going to do today. The fundamental principle, or the fundamental problem that the people of Jesus' day had with this verse is that they took it personal. They took it personally. That is, if somebody hurts me, this law gives me permission to hurt them back. Isn't that what it says? And I can hurt them back in exactly the same way. This was a popular verse, and you even hear that phrase today, eye for an eye. This, we think, gives a great biblical reason to exact revenge on those who hurt us. What could be better than that? Retaliation with the blessing of God upon it. Let the vengeance begin, right? But the problem with that interpretation is that this law was not given to be administered personally. It was given to those who oversaw the community. It was written in the book of Leviticus. It's written to the Levites and the priests, the spiritual leaders of the nation. They're the ones that were to administer the justice when there were conflicts within the community. Just as we cannot take an American law into our own hands and without due process and legal people involved, so it was then with the law of Moses. The law was established to right a wrong through the use of mediators, and it was intended to prevent legitimate retribution from turning into personal revenge. It was given because it would decisively terminate vendettas, not encourage them. The law was actually quite clear that revenge was not an option for the people of God. In Leviticus 19:18, we find these words, do not seek revenge or bear a grudge against anyone among your people, but love your neighbor as yourself. I am the Lord. Jesus was appealing to the heart and nature of God that was embedded in this command. But he's also showing us that in his kingdom, refraining from revenge was not even the ultimate goal. Again, he shows us that life in the kingdom goes way beyond simply following a rule. The original law stipulated that the punishment was to be in the exact proportion to the crime committed. But there's a serious problem with that. And let me illustrate that with in maybe kind of an obtuse way. But you'll get this. I used to teach my kids that it's impossible to be on time for anything. Did you know that? It's impossible to be on time for anything. Because that time, when it's on time, is this infinitesimally small moment in the universe that is so small, you'll never, ever be on time. You're either going to be early or you're going to be late. So don't sit there and say, oh, I think I can be on time. You're either going to be early or you're going to be late. Likewise, we can never expect to exactly rectify any wrong done to us. You remember the phrase pound of flesh? And if you remember back to your days of studying Shakespeare, this comes from his play Merchant of Venice. And if you remember the characters there, there's a man named Antonio who borrows money for another person from this man named Shylock. And Antonio has money, but he doesn't have cash in hand. So for his collateral, he tells Shylock that when the time comes, if he doesn't have the money, he can extract 1 pound of his own flesh. And so, of course, when the appointed time comes, for whatever reason, Antonio doesn't have the money. And Shylock is very pleased to think about cutting him open because he hates him. There are other reasons earlier in the play that you find these guys did not like each other. But then the beautiful Portia steps in, disguised as a lawyer, saying that the contract allows Shylock to remove only the flesh of Antonio, not any blood whatsoever. And therefore, if he shed even one drop of his blood, his lands and goods would be forfeited under Venetian laws. And she tells him furthermore that he must cut precisely 1 pound of flesh, no more, no less. She advises him that, quote, if the scales do turn, but in the estimation of a hair, thou diest, and all thy goods are confiscate. And of course, this is impossible. So the pound of flesh is never extracted. And so it is with any attempt to bring retaliation. You can never make anything exactly fair. You're going to have to lean to one side or the other. And Jesus says, in my kingdom, we lean way over on the side of grace. Don't look for revenge. Don't look to even the score. And then he gives us 3 examples to illustrate the way of the kingdom. The first is found in verse 39. But I tell you, do not resist an evil person. If someone slaps you on the right cheek, turn to him the other cheek also. Now, slapping in the face in the Eastern world was equivalent to spitting in somebody's face. And the slap on your right cheek was a backhanded slap that was both insulting and injurious. Gary, you have to come up here and demonstrate for a minute. There's an assumption that people are right-handed. And I want you to think about this because it says, if someone slaps you on the right cheek. Now, you're not allowed to hurt me. But this is the right cheek. Show me how you would use in slow motion without inflicting pain. For the purpose of illustration, it has to be backhanded. It's not the forward slap. It's the backhand, like that, which is not so much about...
One more time.
No. Well, see if you can get closer. Okay. It's not so much... That's good. Thank you. It's not so much about inflicting physical pain. It's that insult. And you know what? Jewish law actually imposed a fine for this act that was double that of the regular hand slap across the left cheek because of that insult, that intent to insult and to humiliate. Now Jesus reverses this and says, when someone injures you, instead of seeking to get your own back or to repay him, you are free in his kingdom to do the very opposite. You're to forgive him and let him go free. You're to loose him and let him go, because only then can you be free yourself. Because to return evil for evil, we know where that goes. When we answer violence with violence and hate with hate, this starts a vicious circle where nobody wins. There's no end, and you just wear out yourself and others. And if only we could get that message across America today, amen? But that's not fair, you may say. It's not fair if somebody slaps me and then I'm allowed to let them slap me again. That's not fair. No, it's not fair. The kingdom of heaven is not about fair. It's about grace. It's about forgiveness. It's about reconciliation. It's about love. The second example Jesus gave is found in verse 40. And if anyone wants to sue you and take your shirt, hand over your coat as well. Now, in Jewish law, you could sue to take somebody's shirt away, but in their law, you could not sue to take their coat. Because the coat is not only something, obviously, that keeps you warm, but for a poor person, it may double as a blanket. So you can't take that away. You can only go so far. The coat or the outer garment were off limits. This was their outer wrap. It was their most essential piece of clothing. Jesus, though, is saying, go so far overboard in deference to your enemies that you'll be willing to go above and beyond even what's legal, the legal requirements, in order to make amends. You sue and take my shirt, I'm going to give you my coat too. Judge didn't put that in there. He couldn't put that in there. I'm giving it to you. You know, we're so conditioned to be keyed up about our rights. Yet Jesus says that his disciple must be willing to surrender his legal rights and suffer himself to be defrauded in the interests of the kingdom of God. Meet the attitude sympathetically as far as you possibly can, he tells us, and then concede every point that is not essential. Leave the remainder in God's hands. Why? And how could we ever position ourselves to serve others in such a degrading way? Remember that Jesus is teaching us about life inside the kingdom of heaven. And in that kingdom, God reigns. But he is a benevolent and a generous God. And he's benevolent and generous not just to us, but to our enemies as well. With amazing love that surpasses anything that we can imagine. And he calls us to rise up and begin to see our enemies the way that he sees them. When we're able to do that, we can become deeply interested in what the other person needs, and then we'll be prepared to help that person as much as we can. This is the secret of handling difficult people that Jesus understood so thoroughly. Well, how do we get there? Well, for one, we need to learn how to listen. And that includes listening to our enemies instead of just criticizing and blaming. You know, everybody has a story to tell. I hate to admit this. This is a confession, but Eileen and I were watching Oprah a few years ago. We watched it actually for a couple of weeks. And one night she had, you know, her famous layout of the whole audience. And somebody took three darts and threw them at that seating chart and hit three different seats. And she said, we're going to do one show on the stories of these three random people that we just selected. And then we watched that show. And it was amazing. I mean, three random people. And then they sent the whole crew to their home to find out about their family, to find out about their life, to find out about everything about them. And you had three really interesting stories. Because you know what? Everybody has an interesting story. Everybody has things in their life that would fascinate you. And this is the one thing we need to understand. And I think this is one thing God has shown me over the years. There's a lot of things I've missed, but I think I've got this. That when I meet somebody who's tremendously difficult to deal with, there's a story behind that. And if I can find that story, I'm going to be able to love that person, no matter how cruel they are to me. Because people don't normally come out of the box that way. You find out what happened, the injustices that were done, the pains that were done, often as children, young things, things that have happened when they were young, but not always. But there's a reason people are the way they are, and everybody has a story to tell. And if we realize that when we're being wronged by somebody, sure, I'm feeling the wrath of this, I'm feeling the pain, but there's a story behind this. And if I know the story, I'm going to be able to love this person. You know what? That's never failed. When I find the story, I can love the person. As a matter of fact, that's one of the things we find out in marriage counseling so often. So there always seem to be these issues, and she always does this, and he always does this. You know, it never starts with the spouse. You understand that? Whatever your spouse is doing, making your life miserable, it didn't start with you. It didn't start in the marriage. It started a long time ago. And as we get to know each other and know each other's stories and find out what happened and where those hurts were, it makes it a whole lot easier to love that other person when you know their story. So when somebody's behaving badly, instead of thinking of the trouble they're causing you, switch your attention off from the human to the divine. And this will not change them, but it's going to change you. And somebody has commented that when we do this and when we see them and we're able to love them in spite of what they're doing to us, that's the ultimate revenge. Isn't it? Everybody wins. Right reaction is the supreme art of life, and Jesus was a master at it. So we can take on this response ourselves as we see ourselves and our entire lives in God's hands as we live in His kingdom. You know, losing your clothing through a lawsuit was not a common occurrence then, nor, of course, is it today. What's important is the overarching principle behind this and the other examples. The disciple of Jesus must act like the God who is his Father. When the follower of Jesus surrenders the outer garment along with the inner garment, when we do anything that goes beyond what is required to a place where we are offering things our enemy does not even deserve, then we are imitating the God who exceeds the trivial issues of this world. We become like our Father. Good place to be. Third example in verse 41. Jesus says, if anyone forces you to go 1 mile, go with them 2 miles. There is something known as the Roman impressment laws that were apparently common in Jesus' day. And among them was this rule that a soldier could require any Jew to carry his backpack for 1 mile. Of course, you know, you understand the tension there. The Jews were ruling. There were soldiers everywhere. The Jews were living under this oppressive government. And they had a lot of rights, but there were a lot of rights they didn't have. And they hated each other. But the Romans were the ones in power. And they had the right, as they're walking along carrying the backpack, to say, hey, you scumbag, carry this for me. And you'd be required to take it for 1 mile. And, you know, their backpacks could weigh up, they tell us, to 100 pounds. Not unlike our military people today. I think their backpacks are probably around 70 or 80 pounds. The Greek word used in this verse for forces, or in the older translations, compels, is a special military term. So it is most likely that this practice was indeed illustrated by Jesus here. And the Romans were hated anyway, so the request to carry his stuff was humiliating and extremely frustrating. I mean, here you are in the middle of your day doing what you're going to do. You got places to go. You have responsibilities. And all at once, this guy can come and just break the whole pattern of your day and force you to do his deed. And you had to do it. Yet Jesus says, go the extra mile. By the way, that's where this expression comes from, you know, going the extra mile. Why go the extra mile? Why go to so much trouble when that first mile is such a burden in the first place? What exactly is the point? And as we see this through kingdom eyes, the point again has to do with how we view others. Whether Roman or not, there are people, most likely if you're human, that consider you their enemy. And Jesus will make a lot of noise in this chapter about how differently we are to treat them than the way others treat their enemies. Next week, we're going to see Jesus go so far as to say that we're supposed to love our enemies. But that's for next week. If that Roman soldier makes us carry, or the boss requires us to do something totally frustrating and seemingly unreasonable, or if our HOA leader or a government representative or some other person with power shows up at our house and forces us to do something that really irritates us, can we think second mile?
What happens in that second mile? Well, let's think about the first mile. This Roman soldier comes along. He's coming through the village. And he finds a young Jewish man, and he's looking him over, saying, this guy's physically capable of carrying this thing. Might kill him before we get to the end of the mile, but I know he can make at least a mile. And he despises Jews, so he thinks of this young kid as nothing more than a pack animal with a beard who can talk. The Jew, of course, complies, and he begins to lug the bag. He's very unhappy to be doing this. But somewhere along the way, it occurs to him that as horrible and heavy and painful as this is, that Roman soldier has to carry this all day long. I'm only relieving him for, you know, a few minutes here. He has to do this all day, every day. But in any case, in this moment, the Roman soldier has the upper hand. He's leveraging the Roman law to his benefit. He wields the power in this situation, and he's making use of it until they come to the mile marker. The young Jew says, one more mile. What? I would like to carry this for you one more mile. How does the situation change in that next mile? Because I can tell you the second mile will not be like the first mile. It's almost impossible to think that a conversation is not going to break out here. How does the situation change? Who now holds the power in this? The young Jewish man is now in control. The emphasis of their encounter has changed from obligation to that of loving service. The young Jewish man understands more in the second mile about the pain and difficulty of lugging around 100 pounds all day long. And he asks about it. The Roman all at once realizes that he's dealing with a real human being, not just a Jewish dog. Life stories begin to be told. And perhaps at the end of it, even addresses are exchanged for the future. See, this is what life looks like in the kingdom of God. And I'll tell you, friends, this was kind of painful for me as I was praying. I was trying to think, where's a great example I can give to the congregation of a time when I went the second mile for an enemy? And you know what I found as I really started thinking about this? Maybe there's something back there. But as I thought through it, I thought of again and again and again when I went the second mile for somebody I already liked. You know? For somebody that was my friend, or somebody that was a relative, or somebody that I really cared about, and they wanted me to do something, and I did that, and then I did more. That's the second mile, right? No. Jesus is talking about our enemies. Where in my life have I been asked to do something unreasonable for an enemy, and then I did the next step? And friends, I am really ashamed to tell you, I couldn't think of anything. We need to take this to heart, don't we? How much could we impact the world around us if we were able to take this seriously? Verse 42. Give to the one who asks you, and do not turn away from the one who wants to borrow from you. Jesus gives us this last example, and it's so general, it's almost like a recap of the others. In all these scenarios, he's not calling for a passive acceptance of evil. He's calling for confronting evil with positive good and thereby overcoming the evil. Unrestrained anger, contempt, and obsessive desire for revenge have to be left far behind in our lives so that we're not run over by them. If they occasionally test us, that's natural, but they are not to control us. Jesus invites us to see ourselves in God's hands. And when this happens, our personal injuries and slights are no longer the defining marks of who we are. What he's given us here are not laws of righteous behavior. Notice this, these are not laws he's giving us. They don't cover very many cases. They're just three simple illustrations. They're not all-inclusive of the situations we face in our lives, especially in the world we live in today. We're not looking at the things you have to do to be a Christian or to go to heaven. What we're looking at is instead how people live who live inside the kingdom of God. We see the interior righteousness emerging in those who are living beyond the righteousness of the Pharisees and the Sadducees. The Apostle Paul later summed up Jesus' teaching in this passage when he wrote, Do not overcome evil. I didn't write this right, did I? Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. Anger feeds well on anger. So patient goodness can deflate it. It can surprise our attackers and give them the sense they're not playing the game they thought they were. And you know, when we respond in the love of God to anger and to attack, they're not in control anymore. But what if it doesn't change them? What if they just harden themselves all the more and keep coming at us? Well, you know, we just need to simply pray for wisdom. We need to pray for wisdom from God to decide as best we know how to, on the basis of love, for those involved, what to do. With the readiness to sacrifice what we simply want for ourselves. But we always act with clear-eyed and sincere love. Our grounds are never to be personal retaliation. We must live as citizens of the kingdom, and we must see others through God's merciful eyes. Do not repay evil with evil or insult with insult, Peter wrote. On the contrary, repay evil with blessing, because to this you were called, so that you may inherit a blessing. Right now we have a 2-year-old living in our house. My goodness, how I have forgotten what life with a 2-year-old is like. They are messy. They stink a lot. They make those kind of messes too. They break things. They don't listen. This particular one loves when I'm sitting down and I got a few objects. I'm trying to, you always forget to come by and grab one and run away. It's like, bring that back. It's like, I'm not coming back. 2-year-olds, they wake up at night. They create a lot of stress, don't they? But you know what? They also have a smile that lights up a room. She sings in her little voice. She dances around the house. I've forgotten. So much joy, a little 2-year-old. She hugs and loves and brings light into every room that she plunges into head first. So how should I view this little nuclear energy kit? Is this a messy, selfish, disobedient stress producer that taxes all my strength and time? Or is she a sparkling bundle of blessing and love that overwhelms my life with joy? You know, for this little papoose, it's not a tough call, is it? Likewise, we have to decide how we see others. Are they enemies out there? Or are there people whom God loves that simply do not understand that they have a Father in heaven yet? And some of their insecurity and anger and frustration happens to be spilling into my world. As members of God's kingdom, we have to decide as we look around and see those in our lives. Are these people troublemakers in my life who deserve punishment and justice and revenge for being impossible and irrational and making my life more difficult? Or are they those that are created in the image of God with eternal value and unbelievable potential and a giant receptacle to receive the love of God that they're not even aware of yet? Jesus is serious that under no circumstances should we give in to the spirit of revenge and retaliation. It would be better to turn the other cheek. It would be better to give away our necessary clothing or to go the second mile than to strike back simply for the sake of revenge. More positively, it's Jesus' idea that we should attempt to overcome the hate of others by the exercise of an act of love, a willingness to endure insult, and to think about how we can help meet another person's need rather than think about whether that other person even deserves our help. Jesus' kingdom, his values are completely inverted from this world's, aren't they? His things are different. He calls us to a different way. But you know what the cool thing is? If we follow him, we get to live in his kingdom. You know what I mean? That's a privilege. That's where I want to live. I want to ask you to pray with me this morning. Father, we pray that you help us to understand the real heart that you're showing us, your heart. In Jesus' words here, your heart in your kingdom, Father God. Let us have that heart toward those that would be considered our enemies, Lord God. And this isn't even people that we go out and make enemies. Some people make us their enemy. We haven't even put input into that. But it happens. All of us have people that give us trouble. All of us have difficult situations, difficult people. Lord, we want to live in your kingdom. We want to see people the way that you see them. We want to have the kingdom eyes. We want to have our Father's eyes to look and see people as you see them, as people that you love deeply, people that have eternal value. And that we can be the ones in this world where most people are far more interested in getting their way and getting justice and protecting their rights than looking out for and ministering to people, even those that have hurt them, even the people that have been unfair. Let us be kingdom people, O God. Let us be kingdom people. I want to ask you to stay in an attitude of prayer. Just keep your eyes closed and your heads bowed for a moment. And I want to just give an opportunity here. If you haven't entered the kingdom of God yet, if you haven't been born again, if you haven't asked Jesus to come in and be your Lord, I'm going to give you an opportunity to do that before we go any further. And it's a very simple process that we just need to admit that we have sin in our lives and we need a Savior. Jesus came and died on the cross in our place. That's what the Bible teaches us. And if we repent of our sins, he'll take all of our sin and our guilt and our shame and he'll put it on that cross. And he will not hold it to our account anymore. And the Bible's telling us there's no other way. But we know that. We know that. It doesn't matter how many good things we try to do. We're going to fall short and we're going to feel like we haven't done enough because we never will. And Jesus said, that's okay. That's why I died for you, to take all of our sin away. So all we have to do is believe, repent of our sin, believe he died for us, and then to make him the Lord of our lives. And I just ask in this moment, if there's anybody here, you haven't prayed that prayer, but you want to. You want to enter the kingdom of God right now. Just raise your hand and I'll pray for you. Give just a minute if there's anybody out there. Just raise your hand. Wait just a moment. Okay, Father, we thank you for this day. I thank you for my brothers and sisters. I thank you that we can live together in your kingdom. And I pray that you help us, Father, in this place to seriously and honestly evaluate, how am I treating my enemies? How am I treating my enemies? Am I just enduring them? Am I being kind but being standoffish? Or am I able to actually pay back grace into their lives in spite of the way they've treated me? Father, I pray for people that maybe it's even in a marriage, that the marriage has just turned into a session of keeping score. Help us to put down the pen, keeping score, and learn how to minister back into our marriages, to our spouses. Whatever wrong we think they have committed, that we'll pay back double in positives and in blessing and in grace. With our coworkers, with our bosses, with our neighbors, with those who intrude into our lives and make demands of us. Let the grace of God spill out of us, Father God. Let us receive from you today the grace of God to be that. Lord, we want to live in your kingdom. It's hard living outside the kingdom, trying to do things on our own. Things do not work out well. Thank you that we can live in your kingdom. Let us be kingdom children. Let us access everything you have. Let us access the love and joy and the power of the Holy Spirit to be able to pay back grace when wrong is done to us. Let us open ourselves up to just allow your Spirit to come in. Just like we have to surrender to be saved, let us surrender in these areas, saying, Lord, I can't be good to this person who's hurt me. And I surrender. Let your Spirit come in and empower me to pay back good for evil. Let me go the second mile with my enemy. Let me go the second mile with the person who's totally irrational but can hold something over me. Let us be kingdom people, O God. Thank you for your word today. Let it penetrate deep into our spirits. In Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. Thanks for being here. Don't be in a hurry to leave. A couple things. Sign up, please, for the carnival. We do have coffee and things next door prepackaged that you can have to eat. And also, Sadiq's brought in, we have peppers out there and cucumbers, and I think one zucchini. So please take that out in the lobby before you go. And thank you for bringing that. That was very kind of you. So God bless you all. Thanks for being here.